Thanks for everyone for coming out. Today we're going to talk about fruits of Florida. And we're in a really special place here in Dunedin that we are, you know, in central Florida, but we're on the coast. And we can grow a very wide variety of fruits. We're warm enough to grow a lot of the subtropical fruits, but we're also cool enough to grow some of the different temperate fruit species. So this is actually one of the most diverse fruit growing regions on Earth, where we can really just grow a wide variety of fruits. I have over 120 fruits on this presentation we're going to go over, and that's only a fraction of the fruits you can grow. I would estimate you could grow over 500 species of fruits here in this area. And species are fairly broad, because within those species, there's up to 10,000 varieties of some of these species. So things like avocado, there's 10,000 plus varieties on Earth. And in Florida alone, there's, you know, at least 2,000 varieties that are in various collections. So we're very lucky to be here. I'm going to go over a lot of stuff. It's a pretty jam-packed presentation, so usually I ask to give questions during the presentation, but I'm going to ask if you can maybe write a note and hold them to the end so I can get through some of this information. So first, I'm going to start out going over a little bit of the techniques and some of the tips for growing these fruits, and then I'm going to actually go into the fruits themselves and talk a little bit about the actual species and their culture and taste and maybe how you'd eat them as well. So some of the stuff's unusual. There are some species that y'all are going to be familiar with, like avocados, mangoes, bananas, things like that. I really don't go into citrus here. There's a lot of species of citrus and a lot of varieties of citrus that were a good choice at one point here in Florida, but now with greening is so prevalent, citrus is a very hard crop to grow here. And if you have citrus trees, you're going to find that there's a lot of issues with those trees. And you know, greening is a disease that's spread by an insect called a psyllid, and it basically is a bacterial infection that takes over the tree. And it affects the nutrient uptake from the roots to the top of the tree. So within a couple years of getting the disease, the tree starts to die off, the fruit becomes poor quality, and it's a difficult thing to grow. So I'm gonna talk about other alternatives to citrus that are gonna grow well here. And when it comes down to it, we're eating food for nutrients. You know, a lot of us eat food for pleasure as well, which, you know, I'm a foodie, I love all different types of food. But when it comes down to nutrients, citrus are fairly poor compared to a lot of these species I'm gonna talk about. So some of these things have many, many times more nutrients per gram of food than citrus does in terms of vitamin C and some of those vitamins and carbohydrates. So we're gonna get started here. Does anyone, first of all, let's get a show of hands. Does anyone have any fruit trees growing? Oh, wow, okay, great. So, you know, fruit trees come in all different shapes and sizes, and even if you live in an apartment or a small yard, you can grow some of these things, and they're not all trees. There's a little bit of a misnomer when I'm saying fruit trees. A lot of these things are vines, shrubs, small plants, even like pineapples, you can have in a small pot and get a nice, delicious, sweet fruit in a very small area. So there's a fruit for almost every space in every yard or porch or balcony even. So like Deb said, I'm with Sense of Place. This is a company I just started recently. So I'm an ecological design company. I do edible landscaping, farm design, garden design. I do consultations and I do various classes. So my website is just getting started this week. It's not actually up yet. It'll be up by next week. But I have this domain registered, senseecological.com. So I'm going to have a weekly blog where I'm going to talk about different fruits, different gardening techniques, different tips. I'm also going to have my different classes on there. So I do classes on everything from wild foraging for different wild edible plants to wild medicinal plants to fruit tree gardening like we're talking about today, organic gardening, building soils. There's a bunch of different classes I do. One of my other favorite ones is perennial vegetables. So that's a whole neat other thing that we can grow here in this part of the state with this subtropical climate we have. So my email here is tw@senseecological. If you have any questions ever, if you, you know, have some idea that you got after this class and you want to follow up with a question, feel free at any time to email me and I'll answer those questions. So I love sharing knowledge and educating y'all about what you can grow here, because it's just such a, to me, an underrated part of living here. That's why I named the business Sense of Place, because growing these types of fruits in this unique climate we live in gives you a sense of place. A sense of place is basically an understanding and an appreciation for where you live. And if you live in Minnesota, you know, you're not going to be able to grow any of these things. If you live even in Georgia, most of these species won't grow there. Even if you live in North Florida, Gainesville, a lot of these species won't grow there. Because you're here in Dunedin, and you're here on the west coast of Florida, the beautiful Gulf Coast, you really have this special sense of place. So some of these species, when you grow them, you're going to really fall in love with the area even more, I found. That you're going to say, wow, I can grow these different fruits. This is really neat. And it's very unique and very special. So that's where I'm at. So Here's a picture of me in one of my first fruit tree gardens. I used to live down in Fort Myers. It's even a little bit more tropical down there, so we can play with some more species. But being right here on the coast, you have this little buffer zone. So we're going to talk about some of those ideas here in a second. This is just a picture of a fruit display that I did. And these are all different species of fruits that'll grow here. So these are just tomatoes in the front, but there's some neat heirlooms. But we have longans, peaches, sapodilla, black sapote, canistel, pink guavas, white guavas, plantains, jackfruit, pineapples, all kinds of stuff. Ice cream bean. These are just a few fruits that'll grow here. So, like I said, here in Dunedin, we're in a particular climate zone where it's a little bit different than some of the other surrounding areas. When you're growing some of these trees, even though we're in a warmer spot, I still want to mention some of these terms that will help you grow more of these subtropical fruits. So we do still get frost here occasionally, depending on where exactly you are. The general rule is the further inland you are and the further north you are, the more frost you're going to receive, the more risk of frost. So being near to the water, being near to cities and other concrete, you know, areas, you're going to have more protection from frost. So a protected location is an area where you're protected from strong winds, and the winds that we're really concerned with when it comes to frost are north winds, and northeast winds are some of the worst. And anywhere that you have some protection from those winds, which are cities, you know, on the edge of a windbreak, so that could be a row of bamboo or other trees, and near the water, near lakes, on hills, these are other, you know, examples of protected locations. So another thing to consider when you're planting fruit trees is the sun position. And when I first started doing this, you know, years ago, you don't always consider that. You say, this is a beautiful spot for this tree right here. Like, I would love this mango right here because it just aesthetically it's pleasing, or you have the space there, or it's easy to get to. But a big thing to consider is the sun position. The sun changes position throughout the sky during the year. So in the wintertime, the sun's very low in the horizon to the south. That's why we have shorter days, often, you know, cooler weather. Obviously, we have the cold fronts that influence that as well. And as you get more towards the summertime, the sun's directly overhead and you have longer days. So when you're planting a tree, if you're out in the wintertime looking at it, you may get blasting light because the sun's so low, it's going below this tree over here, or it's, you know, at a certain angle that you're getting more light than you may have in the summertime. Or in the summertime, you're getting more light than you would have in the wintertime. So you want to consider these things when you're designing your fruit tree garden or planting fruit trees, that the sun is not always constant in the sky. That makes a big difference. Some of these species can grow in partial light, but a lot of these things like more sunlight. If you want to maximize your sun, your exposure to sunlight, you want to plant the shortest trees to the east and the south of your property. That's going to allow maximum sunlight throughout the year. You really don't want to block the morning sunlight. We have such intense sun here. If you are going to block a little bit of sunlight, go for the afternoon sun. Most plants really prefer to have strong morning sun to midday sun, and they can tolerate a little bit of afternoon shade because we have such an intense sun here that these species don't necessarily need the full day of sun. But if you have the option, morning sun's almost always better. And I've kind of equated it to, you know, when you're waking up in the morning, if someone were to walk up to you with a spotlight and shine it right in your eyes, you're going to get kind of stressed out. But if you can wake up in the morning with a dim, you know, bed lamp you turn on next to your bed, and you kind of wake up and you get out and you walk outside, you kind of acclimate to the sunlight. It's a little bit easier on you, and it's the same with plants. If they're in shade all day because they have morning sunlight blocked by a tree or a building, and then all of a sudden the sun's at full intensity like a spotlight right in your eyes and hits those plants, they don't have time to wake up and to adjust to that. And I've seen that especially with some of the more sensitive species. They really get stressed out by that. And if they have that morning sun, they get that kind of morning glow, and they can kind of wake up and they start doing their thing, getting their biorhythms going. And then, you know, that they can adjust to that warming sun as it gets more intense and more bright. So this is an example, like in an agricultural setting, of a sun trap, where you can actually use this to your advantage to ripen crops that maybe are more tropical. So you can create an area where the sun's focused, where you can have, you know, a species like jackfruit or something that needs a little bit more warmth, a little bit more intense light to ripen the fruit. So heat islands, very important when you're in these urban areas. And that's basically the idea that concrete, metal, buildings, they all hold more heat than the woods will. Because these materials absorb heat and they release it throughout the night. And the other big thing is, in an urban heat island, during the wintertime we heat our buildings. So all the houses and commercial buildings have heat, and they're not perfect. As you know, if you ever pay the power bill during that time of the year, heat escapes and it's going to warm the surrounding area. So that makes a huge difference with some of these fruits that we'll find inland. If you're, let's say, out in the country in Central Florida, you're going to have a lot of frost. But if you go into Orlando, because there's all this concrete and roads, asphalt, metal, you know, all these buildings releasing heat, you're going to have 5 to 10 degrees warmer during these really cold events. And if any of you have grown tropical trees here, you know that a few degrees makes a huge difference between frost and no frost, or damaging your tree, or escaping totally, you know, scot-free from that frost situation. So here's a picture of it. Basically, that this is all much, much warmer than out here in the wooded area. And it's pretty extreme, you know, 10 degrees just makes a huge, huge difference when you're growing some of these different species like mangoes and jackfruit and canistel and sapodilla and all these type of things, that I found that it's actually warmer in St. Pete and Tampa than it is, you know, 250 miles south along the coast. If you're in a rural area, like you're in Estero, Florida or something down there, that you're actually going to have more protection from frost because of that heat island effect, because of all that urban, you know, development. So it's good and bad. So microclimates is another term that there's certain areas, even parts of your yard, that have a great variation from the general climate in that area. So if you look at the USDA, you know, information about growing fruits, or the Extension Office, you know, IFAS fruit growing information, it's very broad, which is very confusing. They'll say, you're in zone 9, you can grow this. You're in zone 10, you can grow this. If you look at the zones, they stretch across the entire state. And there's such a difference in microclimate, even right here in Dunedin. You know, St. Pete's warmer than Dunedin. Tampa's a little bit warmer than Dunedin, just because of, you know, that urban heat island effect, and because those are peninsulas, so they're actually sticking out further out into the water. So that makes a big difference. So microclimates are really affected by the urban heat island effect and bodies of water, especially the Gulf of Mexico. Water changes temperature more slowly than the air does, so it holds heat and it releases heat. That makes a huge difference when you're growing some of these tropical species. So microclimates can vary so much. I've done some different studies on microclimates, and I worked with the Naples Botanical Gardens. We put out these little data loggers that they record temperature every 15 minutes, and you can plug it into your computer and create graphs to show the range of temperature. And just on this one garden in a 30-acre area, we had a 10-degree temperature variation. So in one part, or actually it was 12 degrees, one part of the garden we're below freezing, and the other part you're totally not even near frost at all. So it makes a huge difference when you're planting an area. And you can observe this by, if you have a frost, going out and seeing where sensitive plants have frosted. You can start to learn more about this through observation. A big thing is slope, which I don't really talk about a lot because most of Florida is very flat, but there are some hilly areas, especially in Central Florida, you know, near the Lake Wales Ridge and up in your Brooksville area. The general rule is if you're up on a slope, especially a south-facing slope, you're not going to have very much frost damage because frost always settles to the lowest point. So if you're on a low area and there's high areas around you, you're going to have much more frost and much more cold than these other areas. And it's not a huge difference, but for these plants, it makes a huge difference. You know, for us, it's a couple degrees, so you're still going to be bundled up in a jacket anyway. But for these plants, you can have a dead tree over here, and up on this hillside, your tree is totally fine. So frost is always going to settle to the lowest area. So a little bit about plants real quick. You know, a lot of these species we're going to talk about, there's different varieties. So like I said, there's up to 10,000 varieties of some of these species, and probably even more that have not been recorded. So some species are true to seed, which means you can plant a seed, and you're going to get an offspring that's pretty similar to the parent. So I kind of compare it this way. If you have a child between, you know, two parents, the child's going to be different than the parents, but it's going to have some similar characteristics often. But if you do, most of these plants that you buy in the nurseries are propagated through, we call it vegetative or clonal means, which is through grafting, air layering, or cuttings, or root divisions another way. And that means you're actually getting an exact clone. So it'd like literally be cloning yourself. You know exactly what you're going to get. You know the exact characteristics of that offspring. Where a seed, you have variation. But some species are closer to true to seed. That means you can plant the seed out and you're going to get a, you know, similar offspring. And that's usually species that haven't been bred as much. Species that have had a lot of hybridization, a lot of breeding, usually are not very true to seed. So a great example that everyone knows is apples, mangoes. You know, they're not very true to seed often. They have a lot more variation. But that's not to say that if you have the time and the space, that growing from seed is at all a bad idea. We grow jackfruit mostly from seed because it's actually faster from seed than it is from doing a grafted plant. Most grafted plants speed up the time of fruiting because you're actually taking a piece of a tree from a mature fruiting specimen and you're grafting it onto the roots of a younger tree. So it has the genetic information in that cutting of the mature tree to produce fruit right away. So if you've ever bought a grafted tree and planted it, which most trees, you know, available in the nurseries are grafted, you're going to find that they'll often flower right away the first year, but they're usually too young to hold fruit and it'll really stress the tree out. So I always recommend trimming the fruit off that first year or even for the first 3 years. So you're going to get a bigger tree that's actually going to be able to produce a nice crop of fruit versus one or two fruits. So rootstock is what you would graft onto. So a rootstock typically has been selected for certain characteristics, and that's often disease resistance, that's, you know, flood tolerance, and these type of things. So a really important one is for peaches is the rootstock they use. It's nematode resistant. If you go get your favorite peach from a local orchard and plant it out in the ground, more than likely it's going to succumb to various diseases and often the nematodes, which is called a root knot nematode. There are beneficial soil-borne nematodes, but some of these species, like the root lesion nematode and the root knot nematode, actually are parasitic, and they go onto the roots of your tree and they obstruct the nutrient flow, you know, from the soil and the minerals to the top of the tree. So they're really going to slow your tree down and they're going to stress the tree out. And usually, just like people, when you get sick with one thing, it opens your immune system up for other sicknesses. So when your immune system is weakened, it's the same as with trees. If they get root knot nematodes, then they're going to have some other kind of disease often. They're going to get weevils or borers or, you know, a fungal disease. So another important one is avocados. If you go get an avocado from the store, which are mostly Haas avocados, that's a highland, arid climate avocado. It grows well in Mexico, it grows well in California, and those states, and those regions. If you plant that out here, and you're at all in a flood-prone area, if you have moist soils, that tree is most likely going to die. It's not going to produce well, and it's going to rot and get a fungal disease. So with avocados, grafting onto a Caribbean variety of avocado that's been evolved in an area with high rainfall, high humidity, you know, seasonal monsoon flooding from the hurricanes and things, that it's going to be able to withstand some flooding. So some of these highland avocados, like the Guatemalan and Mexican races of avocados, within 6 hours of flooding, they're dead. The tree will actually totally die within 6 hours of flooding based on some studies that have been done in Southwest Florida. But some of the other varieties that are Caribbean genetics are going to be able to take a few days or even a few weeks of you know, damp soil. So that's something definitely to consider. Is planting a seed of an avocado can be a fun experiment, but, you know, oftentimes if you're getting the seed from an imported fruit, it's not going to be suitable for here. So basically, when you're grafting, you're taking the roots of one tree and you're splicing on, like you're splicing wires together, the top, we call it scion, from another tree. So you get your rootstock, which in some cases is selected just for those characteristics like flood tolerance or disease tolerance, and then you're getting your favorite variety, the most delicious, you know, mango or the most delicious avocado or peach, and you're splicing that onto that rootstock. Sometimes when you don't have these issues, like with mangoes, there's not a lot of issues with disease for the root system. You can just get a vigorous growing variety and just plant that out and graft onto it. Or if you want to slow it down, you can get a slow growing, like a more of a dwarf variety, and use that as a rootstock. There's been a lot more work done with temperate species and rootstocks, especially apples and pears and those kind of things, than there has been with tropical species. And there's all, if you look at apples, there's a million different rootstocks. You can select one for growing in a container or a dwarfing or extra dwarfing or a large size, or there's all these different characteristics. Where here, we're more limited to a few rootstocks, but we don't have as many issues with the soil-borne problems for most species. So grafting can be pretty simple, or it can be very complex. There's a lot of different ways to graft. This is the most common way to graft. It's called cleft grafting. And basically, you're taking your rootstock, you're splitting it down the middle, you're getting your scion wood, you're shaving it, you're trimming it down so it matches up. You want them to be compatible in size. You're putting them together, you're wrapping it, and we call it parafilm or grafting tape, and that's going to heal up, and you're going to have this tree that's, you know, the rootstock, and then you're going to have the scion wood, and they're going to eventually grow together. And these can last, you know, for hundreds and hundreds of years, depending on what type of species. So air layering is another method. That's when you're actually taking a cutting off the tree. It's actually attached to the tree still. And you're shaving off the outer bark. You're packing it with the wet material like sphagnum moss. Then you're wrapping that usually in tin foil. And that's actually going to form roots right on the tree. So say if this is the branch right here, my arm's the branch. you're going to have that cut done here, wrapping it with moss, and after a few months, a big ball of roots forms there, and you're going to just sever that off the tree. Usually then you're going to trim the leaves off, and you're going to plant that out, and you're going to have an exact clone of that tree. That only works with certain species. And some species can be air layered, but they don't actually make a good tree, so they're not typically air layered. Like, you can air layer a star fruit, but it's going to have a very weak root system and often blow over in a storm. But the common trees that are air layered here most often are lychees and longans. Those are almost always air layered. They're pretty much never done from grafting because the seedlings are very slow growing. There's a lot of these little nuances, but it gets fairly complex, but I just wanted to kind of go over that so you have some basis of understanding. So a lot of things are done from cuttings too, where you literally just get a sever a branch, stick it in the pot, or stick it right into the ground. The things that you do from cuttings would be, you know, fruit tree wise, would be mulberries, Barbados cherries, dragon fruit. There's a bunch of other ones, but those are some common ones we grow here. Mulberries, you can literally take a cutting right before dormancy breaks and stick it right into the ground. You can take a cutting as big as 12 feet tall and, you know, 4 or 5 inch caliper and stick it right into the ground and stake it so it doesn't fall over, and it will root out and you'll have it instantly like a 12 foot tree. And within the first year you have this giant tree, versus you can get a little cutting and, you know, in 3 or 4 years you'll have a nice tree. But it only works for certain things. Mulberry is a great one to do. We call it live stakes, where you're actually just getting a stake and sticking it into the ground. And, you know, cuttings and all these techniques oftentimes really speed up production. The only one that I really know is actually faster from seed is jackfruit. But I'll give you one great example, dragon fruit. If you plant a seed of dragon fruit, it'll take 7 or 8 years to even get a decent sized plant. If you do a cutting of dragon fruit and take good care of it, you're going to have fruit within the first year. So it makes a huge difference. Mulberry, same thing. You put that cutting in, you have fruit the first year. Versus if you actually can get a tiny little mulberry seed and plant it, it'll be years and years and years before you have fruit. So the one last thing is root suckers or root division. The main thing we do from that is bananas. So bananas are pretty much always done from root division, where you're actually taking what we call a pup and you're splitting that off the main plant and planting it out. The other ones we often do from that are pineapples. You don't really do breadfruit here very often. Curry leaf's kind of another unusual one, but that's done from root suckers, which are little sprouts that come up from the roots. So oftentimes with these plants that do, we call a sucker, where they send out sprouts off the main plant, you actually want to damage the roots. So you go up with a shovel and you whack the roots and you scar it. And as a kind of an emergency technique, that tree will send out little sprouts to kind of spread itself away from the main plant because it thinks it's under attack. So that's what you do with breadfruit and curry leaf. So usually when you divide any of these things, at first it's better to put them in shade and keep them moist. So with cuttings, with air layers, with root division, if you take that thing and put it out in full sunlight, it's going to get smoked because you're cutting off all of its roots and you're putting it in this situation that it doesn't have any roots anymore and it's going to get stressed out. So when you're doing all these different propagating techniques, it's all about a root to leaf ratio, because when it was connected to the main plant, it had a lot of roots. So when you take off all those roots, you want to take off some of the leaves too. So with most cuttings, I remove almost all the leaves except for one leaf, and I even cut that in half a lot of times. So you only have one little bit of leaf for that plant to root out. Otherwise, you don't have any roots, and those leaves are like this transpiring water. They're evaporating water out of the leaves. So when you reduce the amount of leaves, you reduce the amount of water leaving the plant, and that keeps that cutting strong, keeps it from dehydrating. So one of the most important things with fruit tree growing here in Florida, or really anywhere, is mulch. And not just any mulch. If you go buy bagged mulch from the store, it's not the same, because bagged mulch in the store is pretty much just wood and bark. And that's not really what we need. We want to replicate what's happening in nature. And in nature, if you go out into the woods, you see there's leaves, there's twigs, there's branches, there's all these different materials decomposing on the ground. And that's providing a home for beneficial soil life, really essential soil life that these fruit trees have evolved with, and that's really going to boost your chances of success. You can grow trees without any of this stuff, and you can use chemical fertilizers. I would not recommend that. It's very expensive, and there's much more margin for, sorry, there's much more chance of error. Organic techniques have a very large, sorry, I keep hitting the wrong button. Organic techniques give you a more of a margin for error. Because you're feeding the tree slowly, you're providing a lot of diverse nutrients to it, the chances of failing are a lot less than if you're using just chemicals and you don't know exactly which one to put down. Oh, I put too much of that. Oh, it burned the tree. Or there's too little of that. It's got a deficiency. Now I got to get another chemical and spray it with this. When you're using compost and you're using natural materials like leaves and mulch, you're going to provide a host for the soil life that's going to basically help to feed your trees. And we went over that a lot last week in my soil life class. The best mulch, though, is from tree trimming companies. If you're ever to get just bulk mulch, I don't know if they have public mulch here in Dunedin, but when you're cutting down a tree, you're taking the leaves, you're taking the bark, you're taking the branches, everything, moss on the tree, whatever's on there, and you're chipping it all up. And that's basically giving you a more of a balanced carbon to nitrogen ratio, where if just the bagged mulch is almost pure carbon, it's just wood. And that's not giving these trees what they need. The leaves and all those other components and the twigs are alive, they're green material, and that has nitrogen in it, and that helps to break down the high carbon of the bark and the wood. That's actually gonna help to basically fertilize and feed your tree. And all these materials, most importantly, I said that beneficial soil life, you know, it provides a home for that. And the most important for trees are beneficial fungus. So a lot of times you hear the word fungus and you think bad. You know, you think mold on your bread, mold in the house, disease on the tree. There's thousands and thousands of species of fungus, and 95% of those species are beneficial or benign to us. 5% of fungus species can cause harm to our homes, to ourselves, to our fruit trees. Same thing with insects. Thousands of species of insects, 95% are beneficial or benign. So think about that. When you hear insects, you think bad. When you hear fungus, you think bad. The key to everything is diversity. The more diversity of fungus you have, the less chances of a bad fungus coming in and taking over. And there's a lot of great information about that. A great book, if you want to read more about fungus, is called Mycelium Running by Paul Stamets. I highly recommend it. It's fascinating. So these fungus do a number of things. They help to decompose this material and turn it into a material that's usable for the trees. So the trees can't take this stuff up. The fungus take that and they break it down. They release the minerals that the plants can then uptake and then grow fruit and leaves and wood. So yeah, mulch has so many benefits. It protects the soil. It keeps erosion from happening. It keeps soil moisture regulated. It prevents a lot of weed growth. It feeds your trees, it provides a home for beneficial soil life. It looks nice. So I went over this last week too, banana circles. A great way to grow bananas. You'd add mulch on top of this. This is kind of just as you're building it. Bananas are heavy feeders. So if you've ever grown a banana in your yard and it doesn't do much and it's kind of lame, doesn't produce much, it's because you're not feeding it. Bananas like a lot of nutrients. They've evolved in a rich soil setting. And here we have very poor soil in Florida. It's not really even soil, it's sand. And by providing a lot of compost, water, and minerals for your bananas, you're gonna have way better production. So bananas love organic matter. Bananas love moisture, and they love potassium. You know, you hear about bananas have all this potassium in it. Well, our soil has no potassium in it. So how are you gonna get that potassium? You're gonna have to provide materials that have potassium. One of the cheapest ways to provide potassium to your banana trees is wood ash. It's often called potash in the past, you know, potassium is potash, and that's literally ash. So you're adding wood ash from natural wood. Don't go get your Kingsford charcoal briquettes and use that ash, because that has chemical residues that aren't going to be good for your soil life. But by mixing wood ash with your compost and putting it around your bananas, mixing it with your manures, you know, all those kind of things, you're going to have way bigger trunks, which are going to be able to hold way bigger stalks of fruit. So irrigation does help a lot of species. A lot of these species, though, I'm talking about, if you establish them during the rainy season, you oftentimes don't have to irrigate them ever. If you're using heavy mulch and you build your soils with that compost and that mulch, most of these species are going to be fine without irrigation. So pruning gets pretty complex, but the basic idea is, especially on trees that produce off the tips like mangoes, lychees, avocados, longans, you know, most species really, the more complex your canopy is, the more branches and tips you have, the more blooms you're gonna get and the more fruit you're gonna get. If you plant a mango seed or an avocado and you never prune it, it's gonna be very tall and lanky and have very few branches. And those branches, on the tips of those branches, are where the flowers emerge and your fruitlets emerge. So if you only have three branches, you're gonna get three flowers, three inflorescences, and you might have three fruit. But if you tip that tree when it's young, if you cut the tips off basically, if you start to branch that tree out and have a more complex canopy, you're gonna have more potential of flowers and more potential of fruit set. So you can also keep these trees very compact. If you look at some of these older publications, they talk about spacing these trees 30 feet apart and, you know, these giant trees. Those trees were unpruned. People didn't really prune a lot in the past. They'd plant the mango out and they'd let it grow as big as it can get. Have you ever seen some of the mangoes in this area? They can be 60, 70 feet tall. I had a mango in Fort Myers that was over 120 feet tall, that's, you know, 100 plus year old tree that wasn't ever pruned. But if you prune a mango tree, they can be kept very compact like this. This is a young tree, but the fruit's all within easy height to reach. So in this area, you could put mangoes, another one here, another one here. So you could have a lot of varieties in a small area. So it depends on what you want. If you want a big shade tree, you might not want that. But it's also going to be very hard, from my personal experience, having some big trees to pick. I'd much rather go up and be able to pick, you know, a few dozen fruit easily off of a small tree than have a giant tree that has 100 fruit, but you can only get a few dozen and the rest of them fall off, hit you on the head, and, you know, attract different pests when they fall off and rot. So a small tree is easier to manage, easier to pick, and it's very easy to prune. You're pruning one time a year right after fruit production. So if your tree is still young, you could prune any time during the growing season, but if your tree is of fruiting age, you want to pick these fruits off when they're done ripening, then you come in right after that and prune the tree. So it's literally once a year pruning. And on these small trees, that would take me less than 3 minutes to prune that tree. Very quick. It's not a lot of work, but if your tree gets huge, you're gonna have to call an arborist, and they're gonna have to climb up in the tree and use chainsaws and ropes and all this stuff, and cost you a lot of money to prune the tree. But if from the early onset, you keep that tree manageable, you're gonna be very happy that you did that. It's gonna be very easy to maintain, very easy to prune, very easy to pick. So a little bit about fruiting vines for Florida. There's a lot of different fruiting vines that'll grow here, but I'm gonna go over some of the best ones. So bunch grapes are, you know, everyone wants to talk about some of the species they're more familiar with. Grapes aren't the best choice for Florida compared to some of these other species, but I'm gonna talk about some that are better choices. So most of your standard table grapes that you get at the store will not do well here. It's not the right climate. We have a lot of diseases that affect those species, but there are some hybrids between some of those species and some of the muscadine, which are the native grape species. If you think about grapes, where do y'all, when you imagine grapes, what country or what region do you think of? Just shout out or raise your hand. Right? Okay. So where is the center of diversity for grapes? Florida. North Florida has the most species of wild grapes in any other part of the world. There's 26 species of grapes native to the southeast and to North Florida, and that's actually the world's center of diversity for grapes. The main grapes of commerce, though, have come from the Mediterranean regions and have spread throughout the world. But in terms of diversity of grape species, it's North Florida and the southeast of the U.S. Pretty unknown fact, but most of those Mediterranean species of grapes and varieties are going to get Pierce's disease and other diseases here, and they're going to die. So they've actually, in the past, hybridized these with these native Florida species. So you're not going to get, in my opinion, as good of a grape. They're not seedless, typically, in terms of, you know, a table grape. But they still make a nice grape. This is a bunch grape called Conquistador. It's a hybrid between the Vitis vinifera, the Mediterranean grape, and the Florida grape, the muscadine. But the one issue is they don't ripen evenly. So the bunches don't all ripen at the same time, so you have to pick off smaller clusters as they ripen. Muscadine's the native species of grape, and they've actually been hybridized and cultivated to create better varieties. So they have a lot of flavor, they have a thicker skin, and they have seeds as well. A lot of people don't like seeded grapes. So if you don't like seeded grapes, then I probably wouldn't try to grow any grapes here. Muscadines are a lot larger grape often too than some of your table grapes. And they have a lot of flavor. I like muscadine flavor better than table grapes myself, but they are different. So give them a try. They're very easy to grow here. They do really, really well. There's all different varieties. So there's the dark ones are usually a little bit more strongly flavored, a little bit more maybe aromatic. Some of these green and white varieties are a little bit more mild and a little bit more sweet, a little more familiar to a table grape. So passion fruit, if you want to grow a good vine here in Florida, grow a passion fruit. This is one of the most rewarding vines you can grow, most rewarding fruits you can grow. If you're very impatient and you don't want to wait years to get fruit, or you don't want to wait for this big tree, and you like these flowers, I mean, the flowers are phenomenal, plant a passion vine. Within 1 year, you're getting fruit. You get a lot of fruit. They don't live real long. They're a shorter lived species, but they're very easy to propagate through cuttings. And they do grow from seed, but they take longer to fruit from seed. But they're very easy to grow. You gotta have a good amount of space to grow them. I've literally planted vines, and within 1 year, from a small vine, they've covered a fence that's as long as this room here. Completely covered the entire fence. And they don't like to be pruned. Grapes actually seem to prefer to be managed and pruned and shaped. Passion vines, I've noticed, if you start to try to train them and weave them onto a trellis or prune them to an area, they don't really do well. They'll start to kind of die back and not really grow. But if you can give them a big fence to go across, or an old hedge that you don't like to go across, or an old citrus tree is a great trellis to grow them on. You'll have this cool vine that just covers the tree, covers the fence, gives you tons of fruit, beautiful flowers, and the fruit are very expensive. You ever seen them in the store? They can be up to $7 a piece for the fruit. And I've had vines in the first year produce 1,000 fruit before. So they're incredible, incredible vines. The best one here for Florida is Passiflora edulis, and that's the purple passion fruit. There's over 600 species of Passiflora, which is the genus of passion fruit, but only 30 of those 600 species make good edible fruit, and only a handful of those are really suitable for growing here in Florida. So Passiflora edulis, the purple passion fruit, varieties like Purple Possum, Fredericks, and Bounty do really well here. That's what it looks like. It's kind of sweet and tart, very flavorful, very aromatic, very delicious, makes great juices. It's great just to eat out of the fruit itself. It makes excellent desserts. So the yellow passion fruit is Passiflora edulis, subspecies Flavicarpa, and that does pretty well here. It's a little bit more cold sensitive. So in this area, I'd recommend the purple, but if you really love the yellow one, you can grow that as well. But to me, the purple one's a little bit sweeter and better flavored. And the really cool one that you can grow here, it's also not as cold tolerant as the purple passion fruit, is the giant Granadilla. That's Passiflora quadrilingaris. And that is very giant. I'll show you the fruit size. The flower is also the most beautiful of all the passion flowers, I think, is in the giant passion fruit. Look at the size of the fruit though, they're huge. They can be up to 3 pounds each, but it's not as good a flavor as the purple passion fruit. But in terms of a conversation piece, pretty neat. And that flower, I mean, is just stunning. So a lot of passion fruit have been selected just for their flowers, or passion flowers, I should say. But this one has a beautiful flower, you know, really stunning flower and a nice fruit. So dragon fruit's another great one. It's a vining cactus. You think of cactus, you think of desert and arid regions. It's actually a cactus from a subtropical, more of a moist, rainforesty type setting from Central America. And they do very well here. They're a little bit cold sensitive, but you know, near the coast, in a warm location, they do very well here. They do pretty much need full sunlight to grow. They don't grow well in the shade. Some of these species can tolerate a little bit of shade and still produce, but a lot of these vines I've found really like to be in full sunlight. So the passion fruit, the grapes, the dragon fruit, get them as much sun as you can give them, and especially the dragon fruit, put them in a protected location. But they're very ornamental. There's tons of varieties of dragon fruit. The red ones are typically the most complex flavored. The white ones can be very good too. But if you've only had one from the store, the quality of those is very poor compared to some of the varieties you can grow. Those are typically the white Vietnamese variety, and they're very productive. That's why they grow them commercially. And they ship very well, but they're very bland. The best one overall is the yellow one, which is actually a different species of dragon fruit. It's the sweetest, but that actually is, to me, the hardest one to grow. It's slower growing, it's not very high yielding, and it actually fruits in the wintertime, so you have more chance of frost affecting the fruit set. So small trees for Florida. Bananas, like I said, one of the best things to grow here. Bananas like a rich soil, they like a lot of mulch, they like a lot of compost, they like a lot of water, but they're very rewarding. They fruit oftentimes in the first year. And there's all different types of bananas you can grow here, from dwarf trees that are 5 foot tall, that make a nice little bunch of fruit, to some of these large varieties like Ceiba that can get 30 feet tall and have a 36 inch, you know, trunk diameter to them. So I planted a Ceiba in St. Pete last year for a client, and within 1 year, literally the trunk was, it was unbelievable how big around it was like that. And they make a lot of fruit. The Ceiba can make stalks of fruit that are literally that tall and weigh 120 pounds or more. So if you like bananas and smoothies and desserts and stuff, grow some of these bananas. You know, these bananas, the flavor you get is phenomenal compared to the ones you get from the store. All the bananas in the store pretty much are the Cavendish variety. And it's a very bland variety compared to some of these varieties you can grow here. A lot of these specialty bananas, we call dessert bananas. Nam Wa is one of the best flavored ones out there. And it's fruity tasting. It doesn't just taste like this kind of creamy, bland thing like regular bananas. I mean, even the store-bought bananas to me are great. But the Nam Wa is like you took a banana and infused a mango with it and added a bunch of sugar and blended all that together. And they're better textured too. They're a little bit denser texture. They have better mouthfeel. They're not as mushy as a lot of your store-bought bananas. They're really, really nice. And they're easy to grow. They're typically very cheap plants. They're not expensive at all. You can get a banana for, I've seen them as cheap as $5 at the different farmers markets. Maybe, you know, for a better plant, $20 you're gonna pay. And then after you have that one plant, they grow new plants. So out of that one tree, you can get many, many trees with those pups I was talking about, and you can have a whole area of bananas growing. So Barbados cherry is another great one for this area. It has one of the highest vitamin C contents in the world. There was commercial production going for a while of Barbados cherry just for the vitamin C. Compared to oranges, each cherry is like eating five oranges for vitamin C content. So these can fruit for 9 months out of the year here on the coast. They're a little bit cold sensitive, but they do well for basically from like Dunedin south. I've seen nice trees up in Newport Richey and stuff along the coast too, but inland and further north, they really don't do well. So if you have a little bit of space, these are a smaller, you know, kind of a compact tree. I would highly recommend this. They fruit, you know, throughout the year, super nutritious, and they're very nice flavor. So especially if you have kids or grandkids, plant one of these because it's like a vitamin C pill to keep the kids really healthy, and they're kind of sweet and tart, so they're really, really nice. Sugar apple is a great one for this area. It's in the genus Annona, and all these Annonas, if you've ever heard of another one called Cherry Moya, there's another one called Soursop or Guanabana is very popular. Sugar apple is one of the best species of Annona for this area. It's a very cool looking fruit. It's kind of like a little reptile, and it's inside, it's like a creamy custard. So most fruits that we're accustomed to are typically on the more of the acid side. You know, you have oranges, mangoes, you know, even apples have a little bit of tartness. These have no acidity. They're sub-acid, they're just totally creamy, and it's like you're eating a custard, you know, more like a banana. But it's like you took a banana and blended it with coconut milk or something and made this delicious custard. And these trees are compact and they do very well here. They're very easy to grow. There's red ones, there's green ones, there's brown and gray, all different varieties of them. And there's all different other Annonas that grow here too. Adamoya is another good one that grows well here. And it's the sugar apple, Annona squamosa, crossed with Annona cherry moya, which is the really popular one they grow out in California. And that one's from Peru. And it likes a little bit cooler climate than we have. The cherry moya is typically thought of as the best Annona. It's a large fruit, it's very juicy, it's very flavorful, very aromatic, but it doesn't take our climate. So they've crossed that with the sugar apple, Annona squamosa, to make one that's tolerant to our humid lowland climate here. And these are very good, and they have all different range too. There's pink skin ones, red skin, yellow, white, all different types. So custard apple is another good choice. It's one of the only Annonas that fruits in the springtime. Most of the other Annonas fruit in the late summer, or early fall, but the custard apple, I just saw one the other day with nice big fruit on it. They fruit in the early springtime to late spring, so depending on where you are and what variety, but springtime is their season. And they're a larger fruit than the sugar apple, and they're thicker in consistency, a little bit more custardy, a little less juicy, but they're very good. And this is my favorite variety called San Pablo, and they also call this one the bullock's heart, because it looks like a big heart, like a big cow heart. A little bit about low chill stone fruits. You can grow peaches, plums, and nectarines here, but they're actually special varieties that have been selected that need less hours of cold. So most of your fruit species like apples, pears, you know, peaches, plums, nectarines, all these things, they need what are called chill hours, which are hours below 40 degrees. So they need those cold hours to stimulate fruit set. So these varieties have been selected to need less hours of cold below 40 degrees. So we don't get a lot of cold weather here, you know, very minimal compared to Georgia, North Carolina, you know, further and further north. So we have to have these special varieties. If you get a northern variety of peach and plant it here, first of all, it's not going to be on the right rootstock usually. It's not going to have the nematode-resistant rootstock called NemaGuard or FloridaGuard, and it's not going to have the right chill requirements. It's going to want way more cold than we can give it, and it's not going to set fruit. The tree may grow here, you know, if it doesn't get the nematode issues, but it's never really going to fruit. So some varieties that are very low chill, like Ceylon, for example, can fruit as far south as Miami, and they make good fruit there. So peaches, they bear quickly, they grow quickly, but they're usually a short-lived tree. Usually if you get 10 years out of a peach, you've done pretty well. They fruit a lot at first, and then they kind of just die out. They do have disease issues besides the nematodes, so it's not the easiest tree in my experience to grow, but if you do have a good soil, if you've been mulching and composting for a while, it is a good choice to have if you have, you know, the space to grow a lot of different trees. If you only had space for one tree, I would not plant a peach as my top choice because they are more of a challenging tree to grow. But they are delicious and they do fruit quickly, so. Low chill pears. Most of the pears that'll grow here are we call sand pears. They're not very good to eat fresh, you have to process them, so I wouldn't really recommend that, but if you're into making pies and preserves and things like that, and especially if you're further inland or further north, then it's a good one to grow. But if you're right here on the coast, I would steer away from pears overall. They're not the best choice. But they can grow, you know, fairly far south. I've seen them down into Sarasota producing well. So they do produce very heavily, but they're not one you can just, you know, go ahead and eat fresh. They're better, you know, for preserving and baking. So you hear a lot, if you look at the literature about low chill apples, I would not plant any low chill apples. When I made this presentation, I've seen some growing that were fruiting. Unless you're really far north and inland, I wouldn't mess around with apples at all. They just are not a good crop here. And the biggest issue with apples here in Florida is they ripen in midsummer when it's super hot and humid, and it's not the right, you know, condition for them to ripen. Apples up north ripen in the fall and the cool season, and you get a nice sweet fruit. No matter what, even if your tree's doing well here and they ripen in July, you're gonna have a very mealy, bland fruit. It's not gonna be worth it. But there are varieties they say will grow here. Like the Golden Dorset is a golden delicious apple that was a seedling of that planted out in Nassau, Bahama, all the way down in the Bahamas. A guy said he had to have apples, so he planted 1,000 seedlings of Golden Delicious and one fruited and did well there. And that one's being passed around now as Golden Dorset. But it's not, to me, a worthwhile fruit to grow. That's a really good one, Che. It's a very rare tree around here, but it does very well. And it's in the mulberry family, and it's like a mulberry cross with a fig. It's very nice, but it's a harder tree to find, but they do very well. Papaya is a great one to grow. You grow them from seed. They grow very fast. Papaya has been grown in Florida for over 2,000 years or maybe even longer, but there's actually record of those for at least 2,000 years. It's called radiocarbon dating, where they test the seed and look at the radioactive isotopes and tell how old that tree is. And the Calusa, the natives that lived along the coast from really Tampa south, were growing a lot of these, and they believe they brought them over from Mexico through trade. They grow very quick. They are a little cold sensitive, but they can freeze down and come back very nicely. They do have some issues with the papaya fruit fly. But often if you keep your tree very healthy, you don't have those issues. But if you do have a lot of the fruit fly, you can actually bag the individual fruits, which is, you know, seems labor intensive, but when a papaya at the store is $6 or $7, and they're not even organic at that price, because they charge, you know, $1.50 a pound, and they're very large fruit usually, to me it's worth putting a bag over it. So you can use, you know, custom made mesh bags. I've seen pantyhose work well. Some people even use paper bags if it's during the dry season. When it's raining, the paper bags don't work well. So guava's one of my favorite fruits. It's another one that can get fruit fly issues here in Florida, but it does very well here. They grow very, very fast and they fruit very quickly. And to me, it's a very delicious, very aromatic fruit. And there's a lot of different varieties of guava. There's white Thai guavas, which are very large. There's smaller pink guavas, yellow guavas, all different types, but they're typically all very, very nice, like a ripe pear texture, and they're very sweet and very aromatic. Catley guava is another species of guava. It's a smaller fruit, does very well here, very ornamental too. Patomba is a kind of a rare one, but trees are available. It's my favorite small tree for Florida. It's not planted very often, but it's very, very delicious fruit. It's like a passion fruit crossed with an apricot. One little fruit, when it's ripe, you can smell from 20 feet away. It's so strongly scented and perfumed. And it's a delicious, delicious fruit. It has a really unique flavor. It's a very strong flavor. And the trees are small and compact and very ornamental, too. Grumachama is another one. It's related to Patomba. Not my favorite fruit after growing it for quite a few years. The flowers are pretty neat. They smell like hickory smoked bacon. Literally. If you smell them, you're like, that's bacon right there. But the fruit does not taste like bacon. It doesn't really taste that great. Supposedly it was the best cherry for Florida that tastes more like a northern cherry. But after growing quite a few of the trees, I don't really like it, so I don't really grow it anymore. But I gotta try everything. But it's a very ornamental tree. So it can be used as a hedge. Very beautiful flowers, very beautiful new growth. So Japoticaba is one that is just a completely awesome tree. It's very unusual. It's very slow growing. And very slow to fruit too. They can take 8 years from seed to fruit, and they're typically not grafted. They're almost always grown from seed. But the Brazilians, you know, that's where the fruit's from, the Brazilians say the best time to plant a Japoticaba was 10 years ago, but the next best time is today. So if you don't, you know, if no one plants Japoticabas, no one's ever gonna have the fruit, because they take a long time to fruit. So everyone needs to plant a Japoticaba if you have the space. A bearing size tree can sell for $1,000 though. So they're very, very, you know, rare compared to some of these other trees, and they're slow growing. But here's the tree. They're coleopterous. The fruit comes right off of the trunk and the main branches. Even the exposed roots will produce fruit. And it's like a delicious grape. It's like a very creamy, aromatic grape. It's very similar to a muscadine grape, where it has a thicker skin. You gotta wait till it's fully ripe, or else the skin's kind of tough and not that good. But I would highly recommend growing a japonicaba. They're very beautiful, they're very compact, you know, they're great to have in containers even. You can grow them in a very small yard and you can get a lot of fruit. Once they're of bearing age, they can fruit 7 times per year. And it's one of the fastest fruits to ripen from flower to ripe fruit. It can take as little as 3 weeks from a flower to a ripe fruit. Where like an avocado takes 9 months from a flower to a ripe fruit, or citrus often takes 8 or 9 months. Some trees like Mamey Sapote, which I don't really go into in this class, they can take 2 years from flowering to ripe fruit. So if you're impatient, 3 weeks is nice. Mulberries are a great one. There's all different kinds of mulberries here. There's dwarf mulberries if you don't have a lot of space. They're a smaller fruit and a more compact tree. Figs, they grow well here, but they often have nematode issues, so they don't grow as well as they do in other parts of the country. So I wouldn't highly recommend figs, but if you love figs, you can grow them. As long as you add more organic matter to the soil and more mulch, they're gonna have less nematode issues. Persimmons do fairly well. They're definitely better the further north and inland you are. They like a little bit more cold hours when we get here. So blueberries are one everyone wants to grow here, and they commercially do grow a lot of blueberries. I find it's one of the hardest crops to grow here. They like very particular soil requirements. They have a lot of disease issues, and they're overall very finicky plants. They almost need irrigation. They need very acid soil, which we don't have here, and you gotta provide them with a lot of supplements. They're easier to grow in containers, so you can keep their soil just how they like it. In the ground, they require a little bit more work. They can definitely be grown here because they have a pretty large commercial industry of blueberries. That's typically, you know, a little bit further north than inland. But, you know, to me, it's a harder plant to grow. If you want a berry, a mulberry is much easier to grow, and there's all different varieties of really good mulberries out there. Prickly pear cactus, it's very easy to grow. There's a lot of different varieties. You can literally just take a cactus pad and stick it in the ground and grow a plant. They do have a lot of thorns, though, so if you're not into that, I wouldn't recommend it. Blackberry is not the best crop for here because most of the varieties that do good here are thorny blackberries. And most of the other parts of the country, they've selected thornless blackberries, but those do not really do well here in this region. You know, the further north and inland, they do pretty good, but the thorny blackberries are the only ones that really, really do well along the coast. And unless you have a big yard, these are really thorny, like barbed wire mixed with a fishing hook, mixed with, you know, the worst bougainvillea you've ever seen. If you like pain and you're into that kind of stuff, plant a blackberry. I don't recommend thorny plants for most small yards because you're gonna get caught by it eventually. And it could be in your eye or your toes or somewhere sensitive that you don't really get cut. So unless you have a big yard, a lot of space, don't do thorny plants really. Let's try to steer away from them.
But, experience.
Yeah. Mysore raspberry is the only raspberry that really does well here. It's a different species of raspberry, also very thorny. But it does very, very well here. So if you really have to have raspberries, the only one I would try to grow is the Mysore raspberry. It's also called the snow raspberry. It's got white stems to the fruit. But it's a good fruit. It's a black raspberry, and it yields a lot of fruit here. It's a better choice than blackberry because it yields more often and more fruit, but it's very thorny. But they grow extremely fast. My friend has planted one from a little plant. 4 months later, it's already like this high and just has tons and tons of fruit on it. But I guess he's into getting cut, so. Jamaican strawberries, another very rewarding tree. They grow extremely fast and yield very quickly. It's a really interesting fruit. It's like the size of a large blueberry, but it's kind of like a strawberry cotton candy flavor. I've had trees, they can grow 20 feet in 1 year from a small tree. So you want to keep the trees pruned so they stay smaller, or if you just want a big shade tree, you're gonna have to share some with the birds because they're gonna be too high for you to reach. But they are delicious fruit and kids just love them. So if you have kids or grandkids, it's another great choice to plant. They fruit almost all year, except for the middle of the winter time, and they make a ton of fruit, and they're just so easy to grow.
What is it called?
It's called Mantinga or Jamaican strawberry. Mantinga calabra is the Latin name. But it's called Jamaican strawberry, Panama cherry, Jamaican cherry. There's a lot of different names, but Mantinga is like the common name. A lot of people call it Mantinga. When I used to work at the botanical gardens, we had this big fruit area, and we did have blueberries there, which I don't really mess with them at, my gardens, but they actually ripen oftentimes at the same time. The first crop of Mantinga comes in during blueberry season, and it's really delicious. If you can get a handful of blueberries and a handful of Mantinga and just eat them together like that, it's excellent. I'd highly recommend trying it, or any fruit really. They're great in fruit salads because they don't really have, you know, the seeds are very tiny. So you can just throw them in like you would a blueberry, into desserts, into fruit salads, topping on a salad. They're really nice. Just great for eating a handful of them out in the yard too. So my favorite, one of my other favorite trees, I got a lot of favorite trees, is jackfruit. Very rewarding. Jackfruit's the largest tree-borne fruit in the world. The largest jackfruit ever recorded was 180 pounds for one fruit. So it's literally that big around and like 6 foot tall. The average jackfruit in Florida is anywhere from 10 to 30 pounds, but often varieties can get 50 or 60 pounds. I've seen them 80 or 90 here in Florida, but most varieties now are being selected for smaller and smaller fruit. This is one that I would say from seed is the best. If you can get a good jackfruit, especially one growing around here, take the seed out and plant it. These trees here I planted in late July from a 1 foot tall plant, like that tall. And they're already up to the roof here. You can see the size of them. Very fast growing. This is an experiment at my friend's house because they can actually grow very close to each other. They're a coliferous fruit, like the japonicaba. They fruit on the interior and down low on the tree. So they don't need as much space, you know, like mangoes and lychees and these type of things. They need sunlight to all the buds to produce fruit. Because the jackfruits fruit down low in the shade as it is, you could plant them pretty close to each other. So this is a trial where we're doing them as a hedge, and we're gonna cut them back here soon to keep them like that height. This is his back porch here. So eventually the fruit are gonna be hanging right here, so you're sitting out, you know, having a drink or whatever, and you're looking at these freakishly large fruit just hanging there right at eye level. And the flavor of Juicy Fruit gum was originally synthesized from jackfruit. So it's very, very aromatic fruit, have a lot of smell, very unique flavor. It's kind of like a pomegranate in terms of composition, where it's this one fruit with a lot of little individual fruits inside of it that are called arils. So you split it open, and there's a ton of different little arils inside of that main fruit, and they're very delicious. Jackfruit can be eaten a lot of different ways. The young leaves are cooked as a vegetable in Asia. The flowers are edible. The young fruit are edible like a vegetable. The mature green fruit is like a pulled pork substitute. You can actually skin it and then roast it like you would with like a pulled pork, like slow cook it with all the spices and everything, barbecue sauce. And if you're a vegetarian or vegan, it actually looks like the texture and taste of pulled pork. It's not as fatty, but once you have the barbecue sauce and all the seasoning, I've actually tricked people at a party where they had real pulled pork and I had that next to it and I didn't label what it was and people were just eating it. Oh, this is really good pulled pork here. I was like, that's actually a jackfruit that I just cut off the tree. Jackfruits can yield very heavy. I've seen a jackfruit produce over 1,000 pounds of fruit a year here in Florida. In parts of Asia, they can produce 1,000 fruit a year, which can be, you know, anywhere from 10 to 50 pounds a piece. So they can produce thousands and thousands of pounds of fruit. Here, because we're not in the optimal climate for them, they're not gonna grow as fast or as much fruit, but like I said, these trees are planted in late July of this year, or you know, 2015 of this fiscal year of fruit growing. They haven't even reached the summer yet. So by the end of this summer, these could be fruiting already. They can fruit as fast as 1 year from seed, which is crazy because they're such a big fruit. I've seen many trees fruit within 2 years or 3 years from seed. It's very common. The neat part about it is, like I said, it's so diverse. And the seeds are also edible like a chestnut. I've taken the seeds and roasted them and ground it into a flour and mixed butter and an egg with it and made a dough. And then I've taken the pulp from that same fruit and cut it up and put it into the pie with it, mixed it with an egg, and then made a whole pie pretty much from the fruit, just plus a little bit of butter and a couple eggs. So the crust and the filling was from one fruit. So to me, if you have space just for a few trees and you're on the coast here in Dunedin, I would recommend this. It's really unique. It really gives you a sense of place. You know, you can't grow this in most parts of the world. Only in a few regions of the world will this tree grow well, and it's super ornamental. It's a great conversation piece. You go out there and see this. You can see how close to the ground this is. I've even seen these growing right on the ground. They'll come right out of the base of the tree and lay on the ground like a watermelon. The first time I saw that, I thought the fruit had fallen off, so I went to grab it, and it was connected to the tree. I was at a botanical gardens where you're allowed to eat all the fruit that falls, but you can't pick the fruit. So I was like, oh, jackfruit's on the ground. And I was like, oh, it's chained to the tree still.
Full sun for that.
Jackfruits can take full sun, but they also can do pretty well in partial sun. So mango is a great one to grow here. There's a ton of varieties of mango. I would highly recommend planting a mango, but I would definitely recommend a grafted tree because there's a lot of variation in the seedlings. if you've ever only had a mango from the store, the ones that are red and yellow and kind of greenish too, that's called the Tommy Atkins. They make a pretty good salsa, or they're all right, you know, in certain ways. And some parts of the world where mangoes are commonly grown, that variety is considered fit for only animal consumption. It's very poor quality compared to some of the mangoes you can grow here. The issue is most mangoes are very fragile and they don't ship well. So the ones in the store have a lot of fiber typically. If you've ever eaten mangoes and you don't like them because they get caught in your teeth, all the premier varieties in Florida are fiberless. So it's even more fiberless than a peach. It's like you're eating this velvety, super sweet, super juicy fruit. The Brix content, which is the sugar content of some of these premier mango varieties, is higher than any other fruit recorded. So the variety, my favorite one's Cherry, and literally it's the most fragile mango. If you pick it, and when you're picking it and you squeeze it too hard, it'll bruise right away. So you gotta pick it very carefully. If you have a picker, it's gotta be a padded basket when you pick it. But the flavor of that and the sugar content of that is, it's sweeter than honey. I mean, it's out of this world how sweet it is. And the flavor is just so complex. Cherry, C-A-R-R-I-E. For this area though, because we are still a little bit cool, I would recommend late season mangoes because they flower a little bit later in the year. So if you see a lot of mangoes around here, you don't see a lot of fruit often because a lot of times the flowers come out and we get a cold front and that knocks the flowers off. So if you plant a late season variety like Kent, K-E-N-T, is a highly recommended one, or Keet, K-E-I-T-T, those come out later. Another late one's Palmer, not as, to me as good, but it's still a good one, and Beverly is another late one. But the best, to me, flavor-wise, are Keet and Kent. And Kents and Keets are very large mangoes. I've had Keets up to 5 pounds on the tree before. The largest mango variety out there is called Lancetia, and it's a good one for further south. It ripens a little bit earlier. Those can get over 7.5 pounds apiece, and they're fiberless mangoes like that big. It's like you're eating a watermelon-sized mango that's just amazing. You're getting slabs of mango like that on it. It's like a big steak of mangoes. Even the Kent and Keets are like that too. You use giant pieces of fruit that you can just, it's, the sensation is indescribable, biting into this fiberless, super juicy fruit. It's like nothing else out there. Mango is called the queen of fruits. It's one of the most widely consumed fruits in the world. It's very adaptable to different soils and different regions of the tropics and subtropics. But again, like the jackfruit, you can't grow mango in most of the country. I was in Southern California a couple months ago teaching a class out there, and they consider mango an ornamental shrub because it grows so slowly there and the fruit never really ripens there. They can grow the tree, but they can't really get fruit on it. So in certain parts of Southern California, they can get mangoes, but that's one of the only other parts of the entire US besides Hawaii that you can actually get mangoes at all. And they don't really do well there. So here, mangoes, you know, just grow phenomenally well. And planting one of those later season varieties, you're gonna get more chance of good fruit set.
Will they ripen off the tree?
They will if they're close to ripe.
Okay.
So if the mangoes, all varieties are different. This one here, a lot of these varieties, they're purple when they're young and they change color. With almost all mangoes, there's a color break. So they go from green to yellow, or they go from purple to red or purple to yellow. But there's always a little bit of a color change. The Cherry is a cool one because, you know, if you only have space in your front yard, sometimes if you ever had fruit trees, people steal fruit, unfortunately, it happens, because they want to get a fruit. And if you have a red mango, like a Valencia Pride's bright red and yellow and super beautiful fruit, but it's very, you know, susceptible to theft because people see it from a mile away and like, oh, I want those, because you can't buy them in the store. People who are from regions, especially where these good varieties of mangoes are, it's like something they covet because you can't go to the store and buy a good mango. You can buy a decent mango there. But these real varieties are just so sensational that people would go as far as to steal them from you. The Cherry is a cool one because it's green and it just color breaks just so slightly where it just turns a little tint of yellow. It's almost like it goes from a green to a pale green. It doesn't really even get yellow. If it's bright yellow, it's overripe. It's starting to rot already and ferment on the tree. So I had a Cherry right by the road in Fort Myers, and people would walk right by that tree when they come to steal my fruit and go to my other crappy variety in the back, the Tommy Atkins or something that's red, like this one, and they'd steal those, and I was like, you can have those things. Those stink anyway, but next time can you knock if you're gonna go get those? Because I'd rather you not be lurking around my yard. But they would walk right past like 300 Cherries that are almost ripe, and they go steal the bad ones because they see the red, just like a lot of birds, you know, they see red and they wanna eat that fruit. It also tricks pests just the same as people that, you know, a lot of mammals like raccoons and squirrels that go for your ripe fruit, they go for the bright colors because they know that's a ripe fruit. So the Cherry is a great one to trick, you know, people and animals too. So star fruit is another one, the last one I'm going to go over, because we're already over time here. We started a little bit late, so I went a little bit longer. Star fruit is extremely rewarding to grow. It's one of the highest yielding fruits. If you only had a star fruit from the store, throw that memory out. It's not a good fruit. It's a bad variety of fruit. I used to work right across the street from the largest star fruit grove in Florida, and they picked them green. And star fruit do not ripen off the tree. So they literally gas them to make them change color. So you're getting a yellow fruit, but the sugars never develop, because the star fruit has to be picked at its peak ripeness to have any sugar content. So the ones in the store are bitter, they're sour, they lack sugar, they're very poor quality. The variety in general is just I don't know why they chose that one. It's just a terrible variety. It's called Arkin. It's a sour, even if you get it when it's peak ripe, it's just not a good variety. This variety here is a Sri Kambangan. It's a longer fruit. It's very dark orange when it's ripe. It's got a lot of sugar content and a lot of flavor. They yield so much though. So if you don't like star fruit very much, I wouldn't plant it because they are very heavy yielding. A mature star fruit tree can yield over 1,000 pounds per year. But that's a tree about 20 years old. Young trees can be kept compact where they're gonna yield less. So if you let the tree grow to a full size, they can get pretty large, 30 feet across and 30 feet tall, and they'll just yield just way too much fruit. And they yield pretty much year round. If you're in a warm spot on the coast here, you can have star fruit 10 months out of the year. I've had them in Fort Myers 12 months out of the year. Pretty much every single day of the year, you can go out and get a star fruit. And a lot of days of the year, you're going out and having to pick baskets and baskets and baskets of fruit and sell them or give them away or something, because you just have an overwhelming amount of fruit. They do make a pretty good wine. I've made cider out of them. They are excellent dehydrated. They're pretty good, right out of hand, fresh. But getting a good variety is important. So Sri Kambangan is one of my favorite. And the other one that's really good is Fuang Tung, which is a Thai variety. It's a big white star fruit. It's very low acid, very juicy. And it's, to me, that one's a little bit more diverse in use because it's less sour and less sweet. So you can use it in salads. You can use it in salsas and things like that. It's a little bit more firm too, so it holds up better to those processing techniques than just eating it right out of hand. If you just want to go out and eat a star fruit, the Kerry variety, which is actually, this one's a K-E-R-R-Y, not a C-A-R-R-I-E like the mango. That's a really good one. Or the Sri Kambangan, which is S-R-I space C-K-K-E-M-B-A-N-G-E-N, Sri Kambangan. So I'm gonna open it up for questions now. Like you saw me skip over a lot of slides. I only went over some of the best ones for Florida. There are literally hundreds and hundreds of species of fruit that can grow here. These are all ones that are a little bit more available at the nurseries and a little bit more accepted by most people's palate. But there's so many different cool fruits that'll grow here.
Where can you buy jackfruit? I've never tried
the fruit?
Yeah.
The best place to try a lot of this stuff that's like the most affordable is Mustang Flea Market over in Pinellas. It's Pinellas Park area. It's on Park Avenue or Park Road. And
Park Boulevard.
There you go, I was totally wrong. They're open Saturday and Sunday. I would recommend going Saturday morning very early. They open, I think, at 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock, but the good stuff gets bought up quick. But I'd wait a little bit longer. They probably might have jackfruit already, but if you go into like June and July, you wanna get there early because it's also in a parking lot and it's super hot out there, and you'll get heat stroke if you don't.
Where is that?
It's in Pinellas Park. It's next to the big, I think it's called Wagon Wheel Flea Market, it's next to another flea market. Wagon Wheel Flea Market, it's actually a flea market. They call it Mustang Flea Market, but it's literally a farmer's market. And it's all, mostly people of Asian descent. Huh?
Used to be a drive-in
there. It's mostly people of Asian descent bringing fruit that they're growing in their backyard, or some of them are growing it on farms like further south. And they have just stuff, totally unique stuff. I go there every time and find something that I've never seen before. So it's really, really exciting to go to. There are a few people selling imported things, but you can usually tell, like, it has a sticker on it, and it's, some people try to shuffle some stuff in there. Like most farmers markets, there's a lot of that going on, a lot of trickery. There's a great article that came out called Farm to Fable recently, and it's all about how a lot of these farm to table restaurants are selling stuff that's not really from here, like fish and vegetables. And most farmers markets are literally resale markets where people are going and buying junk from Hillsborough Market over there or from the Plant City Market, and they're saying it, they take the stickers off from Mexico or Ecuador or whatever and say, oh yeah, we're growing these apples here, And if you know anything about growing food in Florida, I can go there and say, that's not from here, not from here, not from here, not from here. So they found that almost 90% of the vendors at these markets are selling imported food, and they're lying. They're saying that they're growing it. So Mustang Market does have some imported stuff, but some of the imported stuff there is really unique, and it might even be worth trying because it's things like mangosteen and other species that you literally can't grow here at all. Yeah, mangosteen will not really grow here unless you have a greenhouse. But that's a great place to go. You can actually buy plants there for very cheap. You can buy fruit there. You can try fruit there. And the cool part is with like jackfruit, they sell them cut up there. So you can buy a piece of a jackfruit instead of having to invest into a $100 fruit because, you know, they're 50-pound fruit and it's $2 a pound, so it's $100 for a fruit. You can buy a piece to sample. And a lot of people actually let you just try the fruit there. That's a cool part about some of the ethnic markets is that's part of the culture. You can go and say, oh, I want to try one of these lychees. Oh, hey, try a few before you go and buy it, which is not the case at any other markets I've been to.
What's the name of the place I missed it?
Mustang Flea Market.
Mustang, like a
thing. Yeah, like the car or the horse. Definitely go there, and you can start this time of the year, but June, July, August are premier for fruits, and they have just lychees and longans and mangoes of all different varieties. They have the Kerry mangoes there, which you can't buy anywhere. They have the Nam Dak Mai mangoes. They have the good star fruit, good passion fruit. So that's a great place to go. Another place you can go if you don't want to go all the way out there is San Juan Market, which is on Hillsborough. Most of that stuff is imported there, but they do have jackfruit a lot of the year. They do have a lot of these other fruits too. Any other questions? They freeze?
Well, they don't actually freeze, but they never ripen properly.
Hmm.
I don't know how to figure out the timing on that. Or
bananas are one of these things that they just fruit when they want to fruit. Yeah. It's hard to get them to fruit when you want them to fruit. What you can do, though, is just give it more compost and more water during the dry season to speed up. Because what they're doing is that they're basically setting after that rainy season. So they're getting all this rain. And when we have lightning storms in Florida, so this is a very unknown thing. Lightning, when it goes through the air, it fixes nitrogen. The air we breathe is 70% nitrogen, but the plants cannot access that nitrogen. So, you know, plants pretty much need nitrogen to grow. That's one of their main components they need for growth. Lightning electrically charges the nitrogen in the air and changes it to a form. It goes from N2 to NH4, and then the rain brings that down. So when you're getting lightning storms and rain, if you ever notice, you go out there and the plants are super green, it's not just because of the rain. It's because you're actually getting nitrogen raining down on the trees as well, and they're absorbing that and they're growing. So your trees are reacting to that. After that rainy lightning season we have, especially like late summer, they're setting fruit, but then they're ripening at the wrong time of the year. So by giving it more compost, by maybe giving a little bit of supplemental water or irrigation in the springtime when it's dry, they're going to have earlier fruit set.
You said you can grow a jacaba in a container?
Yes. Oh yeah,
yeah,
they do very well in containers. I've seen really big trees fruiting in containers.
Like a half whiskey barrel size?
Yep, yeah, the larger container the better, but they're very shallow rooted. So they don't need a deep container, but the larger the better. The root system on Japotocarpus is literally like that deep. They're very shallow, so they do dry out easily too, so you gotta give them, you know, plenty of water.
I'm new here, and there's an avocado tree in my backyard that's about 15 to 20 feet high. How do I take it? I mean,
That's true for like a lot of your evergreen type of trees. It's not best to top some of these species, but for fruit production, you don't want to come in typically and just, you know, cut the tree all the way down, which you can do on avocados, but that will stress them out a little bit. But coming in and, you know, if you don't have the ability to get up there, you might have to hire someone to do it or whatever, but you can get on a ladder and just come in and, you know, trim the top of the tree out. You don't need to do a lot. If you want to reduce the size of the tree, you can cut it back pretty hard. But if you just want to get it to branch out more, just literally, you know, nipping the buds, like coming up and just pinching the top, the growth where it comes out, will make it grow more laterally versus vertically.
It won't hurt to cut it back?
No. I've seen avocados, I had a picture early on where they'll cut them down to a stump like that, and then they'll grow back. Like if they get an old grove that you buy, like down in Homestead or whatever, it's avocados. They'll come in and they'll cut all the trees down to really low, and oftentimes then they'll regraft those. So if it's an old variety that's not really popular anymore, they'll cut the trees down to a stick, and then when the new sprout comes out, they'll graft onto that. And that grows nice trees. I've seen mangoes where they commercially will come in and take a chainsaw to them every few years, and they'll get these little tiny stumps like that. If they're not keeping up on the pruning every year, they'll cut them down to a stump and they'll come back fine. A lot of trees you can cut down really hard like that. Prune it?
Yeah.
You can definitely prune sugar apple trees, but they don't take cutting back hard like a mango. They're not as vigorous. So typically trees that aren't very vigorous, like a japonicaba, I would not recommend ever cutting that thing down because that took years to get to that size tree. But a mango or a jackfruit or an avocado are very vigorous trees. But a sugar apple is another one that's not very vigorous. So pruning it hard is going to stress it out. But you can prune it lightly, and it's not going to stress it too hard. If it has fruit on it, after the fruit's ripe. If it doesn't have fruit, basically now through the, late summer.
Okay.